thank Alexei and the rest of the team for inviting me to give this talk. The Dutch expression is that you are going to belong to the furniture, I think that is. And I feel that I'm a little bit like that. So at the time I was going to have a stipendium here, and at the time we thought, okay, what can we do? And we got into this idea of maybe we should also understand a little bit about geochemistry, and that, well, maybe we can work on that for a whole month and then with everything will be done. And I will tell you why that is a little bit more difficult than I thought. And also, I want to say something about calcite. Well, we are interested in calcite reservoirs at high carbon dioxide pressure. I will tell something about that. I always encounter people in the corridor, both in Delft and here, who make very useful remarks. And I'm sure my list is not complete, but there are many of these people have been actively or less actively involved in what we were doing. Let me see whether I can pinpoint something. Yeah. Okay, I know. So this slide was already shown by Negger here, which is the famous plot is when you want to improve your oil recovery in which, and you are in a certain viscosity of the oil, that is regime, certain pressure regime, what can you do? And it is not exactly given that enhanced oil recovery can be applied for any of these conditions. But, for instance, steam, you like to apply it at a little bit lower pressure because if you make the pressure high enough, it becomes supercritical, okay? So the steam is not really behaving like steam anymore. So all these things have particular areas where they can apply it. And we were now suddenly, and I will tell you a little bit why that is, interested in low and high salinity water flooding. And I think you will be happy that Norman Morrow comes from the University of Wyoming like you, and I think he made the hype going, yeah? So basically he is very famous, and I think he has been doing actually groundbreaking work on fluid flow. So if I would have measured something like that, everybody would have said, well, perhaps you measure it again and maybe you find something different, yeah? But what was suddenly found in some experiments was that if they are injecting, they say here high salinity is seawater, I think. For petroleum engineering purposes, that is not high salinity, but I took this thing from the net, so who am I to criticize it? And then suddenly they, after injecting high salinity water, they suddenly said, okay, let's inject some water at lower salinity, and lo and behold, sometimes they got a higher recovery. So this is the dream of any manager in the world, you can imagine, because you have all these guys and they want to say, okay, and we inject steam or polymers or surfactants or even more complicated stuff, and they are a nuisance. And now comes this guy and says, don't worry about it, you just use water with a little bit less of salt and you can achieve something similar. So you can imagine that this was really setting off a hype where everybody started to study it. Here I've added some references to that. So of course we had also this idea is that this picture was already shown previously by you. And we had this, we expect that salt will be present at high concentrations in the Brazilian reservoir, so that will be also relevant. So we thought, okay, this must be a nice subject for us to study. And there is also something like, high salinity is a low salinity water injection. you have calcite reservoirs, and they are behaving in certain ways, which is oil wet and water wet. I will not go too much detail in that because it is a whole subject. And the idea is that the salinity of the water can alter the wettability effect and thus the flow properties inside here. And then, these calcite reservoirs you see here at various scales. at a large scale, but they are usually fractured at a smaller scale and even at a much smaller scale. And what is peculiar for the geochemistry is that you have an activity coefficient, which is seen here, gamma plus minus. Now you have to work yourself through a whole lot of unit systems in chemistry. If you are not used to that, it becomes almost a disaster, because they say they have all kinds of equilibrium constants which have units, or at least looks like it have units, but they have not units, but why that is. So they are only valid for a specific, if you use specific, so you want to express the pressure in atmosphere. If you do not do that, nothing is valid. A is a constant, has something to do with dielectric. Z plus is the charge of the ion, Z minus is the charge of the minus ion. This is the ionic strength, say the concentration times the square of the charge. And so you have to deal with this type of factors to see what your concentration is actually doing. So being a petroleum engineer by education, I like to look in the petroleum engineering literature sometimes for help. And actually there is help. There's a book, Enhanced Oil Recovery, by Larry Lake. Larry also wrote a book about geochemistry. He was mainly annoyed by the fact that in his view, many geochemists are just stirring in beakers, and he wanted to include fluid flow. And there is a brilliant work of Apollo. I'm always being Dutch person, I like always to stress when there is a Dutch person, so it's Apollo and Rien van Genuchten, and we have many Dutch people where we are proud of. And Postma, of course, the Ma says that the guy comes from the northern part of the Netherlands, and they wrote books about geochemistry, and that's what I'm using. What is happening nowadays, much I see for this type of work, is that people are from the industry. Mores is a Shell simulator, and Shell is, of course, the target of Shell is to develop something which they can use, and hopefully nobody else, and that makes it life not so pleasant for us. But at the ETH, they combined it with Freak C, which I will be talking about in a moment, and that gives a possibility to to do something about it. So when I proposed this problem to we were discussing with Dan Marsjesin, he thought that this maybe I was applying for some kind of work somewhere else, but definitely not of the simple kind we were used to. So if I were proposing 15 components for crying out loud, then he thought that I became mad, yeah. And so here you have a number of these compounds which are formed if you inject carbon dioxide, H+, and sodium chloride in a calcite reservoir. And how do you get these compounds if you are not know anything about chemistry? Is you use the program of Apollo, is Freak C, and he gives you all this list of all these compounds which are formed. And then I have hypothesis that the geochemistry can be incorporated in multiphase flow simulators by the use of geochemical software. That is that software by Apollo. That is freeware. Everybody can download it for free. There is another program which is one of the students, Ali Akbar Eftegari, was mentioning to me is Eureka, a statistical software. Any data set which you have is converted in all kinds of varieties of analytical formulas, simple and better and less simple, and then it is fitting better, of course, but it gives you a whole choice, and it gives you need 5 minutes, and you need to tell, so I'm not sure whether you are applying for that, but you need to tell that you are not from a company, but that you are from a university. Okay, that is, you can, of course, also once you are working on it for a while, you can also say, okay, I want to solve all the relevant equations. It's not the end of the world. It looks much more difficult than it is, but you have to get used. My mainly problem is understanding. The oil recovery, I think they require indeed a incorporation of the geochemistry. Aqueous carbon dioxide solution depends on the ionic strengths. I'm sure that you did something like that with your Coca-Cola. If you put something in it, like salt, and you will see that the carbon dioxide pops out. The wetting behavior depends on the surface charges and thus the adsorption of surface complexes. I will say something of that. There is a positive effect. That is what everybody tells me and you and everybody else, but which is not very clear to us, actually. A number of people, we say, but it's only effect on relative permeabilities, because that's what everybody says. The main challenge for petroleum engineers, also for chemists, I might say, is to understand the geochemistry. You think geochemistry is chemistry, but it is not completely true. You have existing software, FreakC, I was already mentioning that, MinTech is another one. And I think that dissolved carbon dioxide, analogously to gaseous carbon dioxide, that is the hypothesis, that is actually the main contributor to enhancement of the oil recovery. I have to keep track of my time. How long do I have?
20 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, there was always a professor. When I was a young student, there was a professor, and whenever you came late in a lecture, he would say, can you... I'm always chasing away people already, okay. He said, okay, if you wanted to come in, he said, what is the Gibbs phase rule? You have to tell him that, yeah? And then when you said that correctly, you could enter, and when you didn't know, you had to go home to study a little bit more. And the idea is that you can extend that. In this case, you extend Gibbs phase rule. Gibbs phase rule in principle says that the number of degrees of freedom are the number of components you have minus the number of phases plus 2. So it's a simple equation. You derive it also in one blow. But now we have to correct. Well, this is extensively described in any textbook. So minus the number of reactions, you have number of constraints. The 2 is for the pressure and the temperature. Yeah. And in our case, we had 15 components, we said that. We have 8 equilibrium reactions, I will show that. We have 2 constraints, we have 3 phases, and the 2 is the temperature and the pressure. So we have 2 2 degrees of freedom. And so Damascus was really relieved when I told him this, that these are not 15 degrees of freedom, but 2. Yeah. And then we choose H plus and Cl minus. For the surface species, I will say something short about this. It turns out that they are not contributing to the degrees of freedom. So you can have surface species, and then because of the rest, you already can calculate what their concentration is. And here again, there is a few references. So these equilibrium reactions, they are all of this kind. Carbon dioxide in the aqueous phase is reacting with water to form this type of compounds. And you have an equilibrium constant. And the equilibrium constant is given in activities. And now you say, okay, what am I happy? And the activities are clearly dimensionless. And the activities are dimensionless because there is a reference state which has 1 mole per kilogram of water as a reference, as if that were an ideal solution. It's, of course, not an ideal solution because that is not an ideal solution. So this type of things are a little bit difficult when you first see them in your life. And so equilibrium coefficients is that these things appear to have no units, but sneakily they have units. That means it goes like that. So there's a whole lot of those. And we have this software of Apollo, that is FreakC. It solves all these equations for you. And you can use Eureka to express whatever you get out in terms of a analytical expression. And you can choose between accuracy and simplicity. So that's so this is typically an output of Eureka. All kinds of expressions, and some expressions are more accurate than the others. And then as we said, that everything is a function of the H plus concentration and the chloride minus, only two. Well, I chose H plus and chloride minus, but you may choose something completely different, be my guest. Often chloride is chosen because it is not this guy, because it is not doing anything else. But it was also proposed to use the total hydrogen, and the calcium concentration can just be expressed like that. So once you know those two guys, you know everything else. So you have a number of equations. The equations are the total balance equations, because we have not the conservation of carbonate, because it can also form CO2 or whatever. So you have a number of equations here. And so we have the total inorganic carbon, the total hydrogen, the total oxygen, the total calcium, the total sodium, the total chloride. And here we have added the C-4, which is, we do two-phase, so we have also a hydrocarbon. And the typical equations are like this. You can find that in the Book of Lake, which is that the mass fraction here of component I in phase alpha. Here we have the density of phase alpha. Here we have the saturation of phase alpha, similar to the equations you showed just a moment ago. And then diffusion, you can add that if you do. This is a fractional flow function, so this is this fraction of flow is taken up by phase alpha. And you do that for all the components. I did one sneaky thing which I cannot get from Apollo. I had to look in the literature how carbon dioxide in the oleic phase, in this case decane, is behaving with respect to carbon dioxide in the water phase. So you take a pressure, you look how the pressure dependence is of the carbon dioxide in the decane phase, and you know you use the same pressure to see how it works in the aqueous phase, and then you have a Zeros law in the thermodynamics that say if A is in equilibrium with B and B in equilibrium with C, then A is also in equilibrium with C. So that is the way it went. So you can find carbon dioxide in the oleic phase with respect to carbon dioxide in the aqueous phase. There is a if I am analyzing the equations which we did recently also with Amaury, was that there is only, it turns out there is three eigenvalues. One eigenvalue is zero, and that is the porosity, which means that all problems with porosity are at the entrance, and all the other eigenvalues are degenerate, means they all go with the same velocity. Yeah, it's boring. I'm sure that it is true. But then the only thing which the carbon dioxide, because H plus is only in the aqueous phase, cannot go into the water phase, and also all these other salts, only carbon dioxide can go in both phases. And then in the end, that means that the only problem or the only thing which remains is that the total velocity is different due to the fact that this carbon dioxide can switch from the aqueous phase to the oleic phase. So the expression of the total velocity is given here. The injection velocity, the density in the oleic phase of the hydrocarbon as a function of H+. I did this here for a simple problem, so chloride minus is not written here, but otherwise it would be the same. And then here at the entrance, times a factor, which is the fractional flow function of water, the saturation of oil divided by the saturation of water, minus the fractional flow function of oil at a specific saturation, because that's where all the things are occurring. So I came to this insight not too long ago. Some of the numerical results I present are having some features which we really need to check whether they are right or not. Here we have the hydrogen ion concentration. Here I have the water saturations. And here I have the total velocity. So I can solve for that. And then what happens here, and that is if you have carbon dioxide displacement, again, under the... So what we see is from the injection side, I have to press the right button and not the wrong button. Then here I have the density. I see on the injection side that the oil concentration is mainly dominated by carbon dioxide. And that means that if I have such a case, that the fact that I have a pressurized carbon dioxide in the aqueous phase, it means that almost all the oil will be replaced by carbon dioxide in this case. Oil, well, it was already mentioned a few times in this conference also, is that if you add water to, if you add carbon dioxide to water, water gets heavier. Also, when you add carbon dioxide to oil, it can become heavier, it can always become lower, and so that's why these jumps are occurring here. But the interesting thing is, and we have to check and cross-check and double-check again, but the interesting thing is that the presence of carbon dioxide has a big effect on the recovery. Yeah. Now I have to see how much time I still have. What? 10 minutes. Okay, the general idea which everybody has is that the low sol became popular because everybody thought it was working on the relative permeabilities. I will tell you a little bit about how everybody came to this idea, but it looks a little bit like the Dutch story about sandwich monkey story. So there's a guy in the park who sells sandwiches with monkey meat. Of course, in the Netherlands, that is something which as bad as it can become, and everybody is gossiping about the guy who doesn't sell monkey meat at all. And so I think that with the low sol, something similar went on. Somebody was going to gossip about it in a way, and nobody really thought it through anymore. So relative permeabilities. Also here I have a problem because in the big book of Onar Pur, it's the example they give, they violate the basic idea. So this is the oil relative permeability, the reduction factor of the oil permeability versus the water saturation. If I have a water wet medium, that is what he draws, then you get something like that. And if you have an oil wet medium, you get that. And that would be right, because then the crossover point here we put at the right of 0.5. But in the example which is given by Onar Pur, it's the other way around. So I do not know what to trust anymore. Yeah? Okay. Now, the idea is that for a water wet medium, you need a water film. So here you have the oil, and here you have the calcite. And what the what happens is that there is an attraction force in both sides here, and the attraction force is due to van der Waals attraction. And there is, as far as I'm concerned, if you want to read about it and you didn't read the book, the paper by George Hirasaki, number SPE 17367, it is sufficient to know which paper it is. Unfortunately, SPE has a weird behavior, Society of Petroleum Engineers, in distributing papers. We have consistently said what would be the best advertisement for petroleum engineering if they make it an open source. Unfortunately, you have to pay $10 or $50, I forgot how much. But okay, that's a disadvantage, but this is a brilliant paper on this. Van der Waals attraction, dipole-dipole interaction between those two. In this case, it is attracting. It can also be repulsive. There's a double-layer repulsion, which means that the charges on the oil phase and the charges on the calcite phase can, as if they are of the same charge, they repel each other or they can attract each other. There's hydration forces, which I'm not going to bother you with, and you have a disjoining pressure, which actually says that the water is stable, and if the attractive forces are dominant, then the water film will disappear and the system will become oil wet, and if the if it's repulsive, then it becomes water wet. So here, that is also, you can do that with Apollo, it's very nice. You have all these surface complexes, so calcium, where there is some carbonate on it and what have you. And here you have the concentrations given, and I've done it at two different sodium chloride concentrations. It's a very simple thing, and then you can see what are the concentrations of the various surface complexes, and what you see is that concentration of surface complexes depend on the sodium chloride concentration. So what we, of course, are after is to get the charges. Here there is the charge on the oil surface and on the calcite surface, and if they have opposite charge, you are in trouble because the water film is disappearing, and if the same charge, then you are happy because they repel each other. And so, and then you see also that depends on if there is much millimole per kilogram of water, and this is very little, then it behaves differently. So there is an effect of the charge of the sodium chloride concentration. So this whole thing about low sol, of course, is already a little bit jeopardized. Here you see the effect of the of two different rel perms on the recovery. Actually, there is maybe an effect on the rate of recovery, but in the total recovery, I do not see much of an effect. So I think that that is also, well, I should say eloquently phrased by Cor van Kruisdijk. He says, do you understand what the relative permeability has to do with low sol and how these ionic strengths have to do anything with each other? And this is this typical story of the sandwich monkey story which we have, is that everybody is saying, oh, this is low sol and then it will be better, but there is much more to it than it looks. So I'm coming to the conclusions. Geochemistry can be accounted for by the use of geochemical software to create lookup tables and regression formula. Or sometimes solutions appear to be unstable, but since we are using this Eureka software, I do not have any trouble with it anymore. I used to have trouble with it when I was to use polynomials, and I used higher order polynomials, and they wiggled around, and that doesn't really make everybody happy. Simultaneous solution of all the equations, which we also tried, you can do that. You need indeed the to get the geochemistry involved. The wetting behavior depends on surface charges, thus on the absorption of surface complexes. You can find it with freak C. Ionic strength is not the only wetting modifying characteristic, so this idea of low sol is not the, at least not the whole the whole story. Surfactants modify the surface behavior, carboxylic acid, and the virtue of the water wet relative permeabilities, like Cor van Kruisdijk told me, he's absolutely right, it is not clear. The carbon dioxide presence, I think, is an important reason for enhancing the oil recovery, and understanding the geochemistry is facilitated with the help of existing software, FreakC, but the main problem is not the programming, but the problem is understanding geochemistry. Okay, thank you very much.
Hello.
Thank you, Hans.